Today, we're tackling a mission to really build a structured academic understanding of one of the most foundational frameworks in macroeconomics, the ISLM model.
That's right. The goal of this deep dive is to give you a solid handle on this really powerful tool. It's the core mechanism for understanding how the real economy, you know, the goods market, interacts with the financial side of things, the money market.
And our sources really map out how we can find that single equilibrium point where overall output, or Y, and the interest rate R are stable across both of those markets. Mm. If you want to get why a government stimulus doesn't always pack the full punch, this is the place to start.
Exactly. This model lets us properly analyze that famous tug of war between fiscal and monetary policy. We're going to see how government spending can sometimes unintentionally raise interest rates and sort of dampen private investment.
That's the crowding out effect.
That's partial crowding out. And understanding that tension is really the core objective today.
Okay, so let's get into it. We'll start with the goods market, which is what gives us the first half of the model, the investment saving, or IS curve.
So we begin by defining equilibrium. In the goods market, that just means the total amount produced output has to equal the total amount demanded.
Right. Aggregate expenditure.
Exactly. And that expenditure comes from three main places: consumption from households, investment from firms, and of course, government spending.
This is the real side of the economy then: buying things, building things. And the critical variable that connects this to the financial world is investment.
It is. Investment is the absolute key behavioral link here. The core assumption is that planned investment, think new factories, new equipment, is negatively dependent on the interest rate.
So the interest rate is essentially the cost of borrowing.
Precisely. So if interest rates are high, that hurdle for a project to be profitable is also really high. A lot of potential projects just won't get off the ground because the financing costs are too steep.
Makes sense. High rates, low investment.
So to derive the IS curve, we just trace the logic. Let's say the interest rate goes down.
Okay, so borrowing gets cheaper.
Which means planned investment goes up.
And that increase in investment is like a direct stimulus into the economy. It boosts aggregate demand right away.
And because output has to match demand, a higher aggregate demand means you need a higher equilibrium level of output.
So that gives us the relationship. A lower interest rate leads to a higher level of output.
That's the inverse relationship that defines the IS curve. It has to slope downward. Every single point along that curve is a combination of an interest rate and an output level where the goods market is perfectly in balance.
Okay, a quick clarification though. To define the curve, we're holding government spending constant. But what about consumption? That still changes, right?
Oh, absolutely. When the economy moves to a higher output level, that means higher income for people. And since consumption depends on disposable income, that higher output leads to more consumption, which reinforces the whole effect. The IS curve captures all of that.
Got it. So it's the goods market's reaction to the cost of money.
Perfectly put.
Okay, now let's pivot completely. We leave the world of goods and spending, and we enter the world of money and finance. This is where we build the LM curve, liquidity preference, and money supply.
Right, a totally different market. Here, the focus is the relationship between the demand for money and the supply of money, which is managed by the central bank.
So for the purpose of this model, the supply of money is just fixed. The central bank sets it.
Yes. We assume the supply of real money balances. So the actual purchasing power of cash is fixed. But money demand is dynamic. It depends on two big factors.
The first one feels pretty intuitive: transaction demand. As income goes up, as the economy grows, people just need more cash for everyday transactions.
Exactly. More economic activity means a higher demand for money. It's directly tied to income. The second factor is where the interest rate comes back in.
The opportunity cost.
The opportunity cost of holding money.
Sure.
If you're holding cash, you're giving up the interest you could be earning on, say, a bond. So if the interest rate is really high, people have a strong incentive to get their cash out of their wallets and into earning assets.
Which would decrease the demand for money?
Precisely. So let's use that to derive the LM curve's slope. Imagine output or income rises.
Okay, so that immediately increases the transaction demand for money.
But the supply of money is fixed. So now we have an excess demand for it.
If everyone wants more cash than is available, we'll start selling other things, like bonds, to get that cash.
And when a lot of people try to sell bonds, the price of bonds falls. And when bond prices fall, their effective return, the interest rate, rises.
Ah, so the interest rate has to rise until it's high enough to convince some people to hold bonds instead of cash, bringing money demand back down to meet the fixed supply.
That's the clearing mechanism. So if output goes up, the interest rate must also go up to keep the money market in equilibrium.
A positive relationship.
Which means the LM curve is fundamentally upward sloping. Every point on that curve is a point where the demand for real money balances perfectly equals the fixed supply.
So we have our two pieces, the IS curve representing the goods market sloping down, and the LM curve representing the money market sloping up. Now we bring them together.
And their intersection defines the general equilibrium. It's that single point, we can call it R0, Y0, that gives us the one interest rate and the one output level where both markets are in equilibrium at the same time.
And what happens if the economy isn't at that intersection? Let's say the interest rate is way too high. We're somewhere above that equilibrium point.
That's where you see the power of the model, because that situation creates an inconsistency between the two markets. In the goods market, on the IS curve, that high interest rate means investment is very low, which corresponds to a low level of output.
Okay.
But in the money market, on the LM curve, that same high interest rate can only be sustained if there is a lot of transaction demand for money, which implies a high level of output.
So the goods market is screaming for low output, and the money market is demanding high output. That can't last.
It can't. There's a disequilibrium. Since investment is so low, firms will see their inventories piling up, and there will be downward pressure on output and interest rates.
The adjustment process kicks in.
The interest rate is pushed downward, and as it falls, two things happen at once. First, the lower rate stimulates investment, which raises aggregate demand and output. That's a movement along the IS curve.
And at the same time?
At the same time, the lower interest rate reduces the opportunity cost of holding money, which helps clear the money market. That's a movement along the LM curve.
So they're both pulled back towards that single intersection point. It's important to note, though, as our sources point out, that this equilibrium, this Y0, isn't necessarily a good thing.
Not at all. It could very well represent an economy stuck in a recession, where output is way below what's needed for full employment. And that, of course, is why we have policy.
Let's get into that. Let's start with expansionary fiscal policy. So this is the government deciding to increase its own spending or to cut taxes.
Right. Let's take an increase in government spending, G. This is a direct injection into aggregate demand. So at the initial interest rate, the old equilibrium output is no longer sustainable.
Output has to rise.
It has to. Yeah. And since the IS curve shows us goods market equilibrium, this increase in G causes the entire IS curve to shift outwards to the right.
And our new equilibrium point is where this new shifted IS curve crosses the original LM curve.
Mm-hmm.
And looking at the graph, the result is a higher equilibrium output, which was the goal, but also a higher equilibrium interest rate. Why does the interest rate go up?
This is that crucial feedback loop. The initial fiscal boost raises output. Why? That higher output creates more transaction demand for money across the economy.
But the money supply hasn't changed.
Money supply is fixed. So that scarcity of cash drives up the price of holding it, which is the interest rate.
I see. So the government's own spending ends up making it more expensive for the private sector to borrow.
Exactly. That resulting increase in the interest rate makes private investment more expensive, so it falls compared to what it would have been. This drop in private investment partially counteracts the initial stimulus.
And that's the partial crowding out mechanism.
That's it. The policy worked output went up. But the effect was diluted because rising interest rates pushed out some private firms.
The sources also mention a key difference between using government spending versus a tax cut.
They do. An increase in government spending is a direct dollar-for-dollar injection into aggregate demand. A tax cut, on the other hand, first just increases people's disposable income.
And people might save some of that extra income.
They'll save a fraction of it, yes. So the initial boost to aggregate demand is weaker, which means the IS curve shifts by less.
Okay, let's shift gears to the central bank's main tool, expansionary monetary policy. So increasing the money supply.
Right. When the central bank increases the money supply, say by buying government bonds from the public, it immediately injects liquidity into the financial system.
So at the initial level of income, there's now an excess supply of money.
An excess supply of loanable funds. And if there's a surplus of money chasing the same amount of borrowing demand, the price of money, the interest rate, has to fall.
It becomes cheaper to borrow.
It does. The falling interest rate is what's required to convince people to hold this new, larger supply of money. And since the interest rate is now lower for every level of output, the entire LM curve shifts outwards to the right.
So the new general equilibrium is where this new LM curve intersects the original unchanged IS curve.
Mm-hmm.
And what's the outcome this time?
The new equilibrium gives us a higher level of output and a lower equilibrium interest rate.
So this is the monetary transmission mechanism. The central bank acts on the money market, drives down the interest rate, and that lower rate is the signal that gets the goods market moving.
Exactly. It encourages private investment, which raises aggregate demand, and that ultimately increases output. It's an indirect channel, but a very powerful one. And it avoids that crowding out problem because the interest rate is falling.
And the research points to a few specific ways they can do this?
Yes, three main methods. First, they can lower the reserve ratio, which lets commercial banks lend out more of their deposits. Second, those open market operations, buying bonds from the public to inject cash.
And the third?
Purchasing foreign exchange. That also injects domestic currency into the financial system, expanding the money supply and shifting that LM curve to the right. The goal in all cases is the same: manipulate the interest rate to spur investment. You know, when you step back, the ISLM framework, for all its simplicity, really provides this essential structure. It lets you predict which direction interest rates and output are going to move after a major policy decision.
And that's really the core takeaway, isn't it? Fiscal policy hits the goods market, it shifts IS. Monetary policy hits the money market, it shifts LM. But the final result is determined by how that interaction plays out through the interest rate and output.
They are completely inseparable. And, you know, we've established the slopes of the curves, but the actual impact of a policy often comes down to their steepness. So here's a thought for you to take away.
Okay.
We talked about crowding out, where rising interest rates dampen a fiscal stimulus. But what if the IS curve was almost vertical? What if investment was just almost completely insensitive to the interest rate?
That's a great thought.
Well, if investment doesn't respond to the interest rate, then the rising rates caused by fiscal policy won't crowd anything out. Suddenly, fiscal policy becomes incredibly powerful. Exploring how those sensitivities change policy effectiveness.
Yeah.
That's really the next step in applying this model to the real world.
A perfect concept to mull over. Thank you for guiding us through this foundational framework.
My pleasure.
And thank you for joining us for this deep dive. We'll see you next time.